is going to happen in the global economy. Okay? So this is the plan. It's easier to express it than to carry out. But, all right. So here are the main results, which I want already. I'm going to say a few more things. So we managed in this environment to put enough restrictions on the economy so that equilibrium is always unique. There's no bubble, there's nothing, no reason for multiple equilibria here. This is very difficult in this circumstance where there's politics involved to carry out. But if you insist, you can get a unique equilibrium. So equilibrium is always unique, but history matters. And history of the matter is that countries are identical, but their initial conditions are not necessarily the same. So the capital-labor ratio may not be the same, even though world perfect capital mobility will force capital-labor ratios into equality, but the institutions you inherit from the past are not the same. And the political system is not the same. So you draw from the distribution. If you inherit, even if you inherit a common status quo, if the initial status quo is the same, once you draw from a distribution, a reform proposal, some people will be luckier, have luckier draws, and they'll be able to reform. Some people will have unluckier draws, and maybe they'll reform downward. Okay? So the politics is not the same. And that's going to distinguish one country from another. And we haven't thought about norms being different, but you could easily think about social interactions being different. You could think about some cultures being more traditionalist than others. You can think of the past as being more important for some nations, some societies, and less so for others. That's a possibility here. Okay, so what happens is there's going to be one or more steady states. In particular, if you have strong social interactions, which means you're in a traditional society, a strongly traditional society, you have more than one stable steady state. This always happens in growth models with increasing returns or strong externalities. But if you are strong, you're going to have good equilibrium, high income equilibrium, and a low income equilibrium. And in between, you're going to have an unstable equilibrium. Okay. So this is kind of something that comes here through here very strongly. So what happens is that there can be one or more stable steady states, and let's split this again into two. So we have individual societies where social interactions are weak. So what happens in relatively individual societies is exactly what you expect. So if I ask you before I talked to guess what the result would be, you would guess them immediately. Okay. So in these societies where externalities are not strong, what happens is that there is equilibrium convergence to a state where there's very little corruption, minimal corruption, and minimal rent-seeking, if institutions are strong enough. If society chooses, and I haven't told you how society chooses, because institutions for the time being are exogenous. So if you happen to choose strong institutions and keep them strong, you will converge to a good steady state with no corruption and high income. Hurrah, that's what we all want. All right. If you choose institutions that are weak and keep them weak, then you will converge to a state where corruption and rent-seeking are going to be maximal. Everybody who has a choice will choose to do the bad thing. There's some people who have no choice because they're not good as thieves. Okay, so they have to be honest. And there's some people who are no good as producers, so they have to be dishonest. But everybody has a choice, will choose to do the bad thing. And if institutions are neither strong nor weak, there's going to be some steady state in between. Okay, that's basically the idea. So now, if you want to think about the politics, are we going to choose these institutions or are we going to choose those institutions? And the idea is you could reform and you could grow out of a bad situation But that will only happen if the people who are the impediment, the people who are disposed to vote for weak institutions, are not 100% behind weak institutions. In other words, the people who would vote for weak institutions are the people who have a comparative advantage in rent seeking. So think of the mafia. Think what income do I get if I'm a mafia member versus if I'm an honest worker? And if this difference is huge, so if my income as a mafia member is 3,000 and my income as an honest worker is 1,000, the mafia people have a strong interest in preserving weak institutions, and they will vote, they will veto all reform proposals if they can. Okay. But if the difference is slight, if my mafia income is 1,500 and my honest income is 1,400, then it's possible to have reform, because these people don't lose that much, and the economy can actually improve the opportunities. Okay. Because if you're a mafia member and you remove the mafia from the scene, then the corruption tax on honest work goes way down, and that helps. All right, so that's these societies. The other societies are traditional societies, and I thought we worked with that already. So here, because there's very strong externalities from your interactions with your environment, and it's very important for you to conform to your environment, there's going to be two steady states that are stable: very high income, low corruption, steady state, and a low income, high corruption, steady state. So there's going to be two steady states separated by an unstable one. And all that the institutions can do here, the most, is define the basin of attraction. So the economy, depending on initial conditions, the economy either going to go to a good equilibrium or a bad equilibrium. History is very important. Now, where the dividing line is depends on institutions, or may depend on institutions, if externalities are not super strong, just strong. If they're super strong, nothing matters, only history. Okay. So here, institutions are not very important. It's not like you choose better institutions and, because the economy is going to go either up or down. And you don't have very, very, very much leverage over this economy. So you basically replicate the past. You're a prisoner of the past. So we're trying to kind of get some sense of what makes a society traditionalist or not. There was a sociologist called Hofstadter, and he went and collected information about values, and among them, and based on those interviews that he had, he divided societies into individualist, traditionalist, and individualist. So on a continuum. So this is kind of important for us to get data like that. How important is society to your private decisions, private economic decisions? And we thought that societies would be very traditionalist if they're very religious. So if you can find data on religiosity, there's some data, but they're not always good. So if you can find data on religiosity, that might say something to us. So we need to get a handle on what this thing means. Okay, and now I don't have much time left. So what I'd like to do is take you directly to the politics, show you how a choice would happen. Okay, how society would choose between strong enforcement and weak enforcement. So let's go back here. I'll show you a picture, and I try to persuade you that this picture makes sense. I may or may not succeed. Okay, probably I will fail, but let me try anyway. Because there are lots of steps I'm going to skip, and now there's going to be like many, 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 many slides over. There's going to be a picture. This is kind of details of how people make individual decisions. that every individual decision, if you want to be an honest person, there's a wage you get as an honest person. But there's a probability that you're going to lose this wage to someone who's a thief. And this probability, or the income loss that you're going to experience, depends on how many thieves there are, predators, relative to prey. So if there's few prey and lots of predators, you're going to lose your shirt. However, you're going to meet a predator. And what happens between you and the predator in this model, when you meet one, depends on enforcement. If there are lots of cops around, the predator cannot take much of your income. Maybe not at all, none at all. If there are no cops around, then you can lose all your income. But don't worry if you lose all your income. Or if the predator actually is not successful in taking away your income, don't worry, there's perfect insurance markets here. You can say, look, I'm a thief, but I failed at being a thief. Can I have my insurance, please? And everything works out just fine. Everything is public information. And there's no opprobrium being attached to being a thief. You can go and buy insurance, and somebody says, it's a thief, oh, rotten person. Nobody says this. Okay, so what happens is that this is an overlap. There's here things that define sets of equilibria and dynamics and, you know, all sorts of complicated things. But let's go to this picture, which I'll try to find for you, and then keep going. There you go. Okay. So now remember, this is an overlapping generations model in the diamond style. People work the first period of life when they're young, and they retire the second period of life. So your lifetime income in this model, so your utility basically depends on your lifetime income, which depends on the wage rate, and depends on the interest rate and the taxes you pay. The interest rate is the order of interest. Okay? You cannot influence the world interest rate. You can choose any occupation you want, it's the same interest rate that you're going to face. So the only thing here that you can influence yourself for your occupational choice is your wage income after taxes. And the politics will define the taxes. The politics of the situation, the institutions will define what is the chance that you're going to lose your income to a thief and what fraction of your income you're going to choose, you lose. And it also defines, of depending on how many cops you decide to put on the street, if you're an honest producer, you will have to pay a tax to the government that will finance the cops on the beat. Okay, so there's a wage cost to enforcement, and this has to be paid for by productive individuals. And there's also another tax, which is the corruption tax, or the rent-seeking tax, that individuals pay. So societies decide which tax, more cops, therefore higher wage tax this way, or a higher corruption tax. There's a trade-off. Okay, so what you see here is here there's going to be a group, two groups of people. There's going to be a minimal amount of heterogeneity that we need to have in order to have disagreement in society about politics. Because if there's no heterogeneity, we all agree on everything. Okay, so there's going to be group one are going to be the people. Oops, hold on. Group one is going to be the people who are productive and they have no talent in rent seeking. So these people are going to be more or less producers. Okay. And group two are going to be people who have a choice. They can be producers or rent seekers. These people have a comparative advantage in rent seeking. They're not very good producers. Okay. And that's why you have this disagreement. So what happens is, here is the income of group one. So this is for each value of the institutions, which is the ratio of cops to thieves, we're going to have an occupational choice. And therefore, for this occupational choice, there's going to be an income attached to it. So what is the income? So we start with these institutions, we compute occupational choices, and incomes come out of the occupational choices, and we change theta exogenously, and we do this whole graph. And then group one looks at this particular path of income, and group two looks at this particular path of income, and then they inherit some theta, this theta from the past, or this theta, and then some random theta is chosen today, and the groups have to vote, and they will vote according to what this graph tells them. Which particular choice gives you the higher of the two incomes? You have status quo from the past plus some random proposal today. Which gives you a higher Y? And this is a situation where there's no externalities, so this is the simplest case. Forget about externalities, forget about everything, okay? So it's the simplest simplest way to understand what goes on. So what you see basically is that the incomes go down and then they go up. Okay. So when you start increasing enforcement, incomes initially go down. And they initially go down because what you're doing when you go from zero enforcement to epsilon enforcement, nobody switches occupation. There's not enough enforcement to persuade the rent seekers to behave honestly. Okay? So all that happens is you tax people more. You tax these guys who pay the taxes. These are the honest people, the producers. You tax them. So their after-tax income goes down. And what you do with these guys is you just bother them. Okay? Because you make them less successful as thieves. You don't persuade them to give up thieving. The thieves. But they pay a tax now. In other words, when they stick you up, they don't get 10 bucks, they get 5 bucks. So the income goes down like this. And there's a point where things turn over, you increase enforcement, so then people start switching. These people here, because now the enforcement is too strong, they say, well, it's not worth it. So let me switch, they start switching into honest work, and then their income goes up, and these people, of course, get relief. When the thieves switch, or when the rent seekers switch, these people get relief. So they pay a tax, but what they save in the corruption tax or the rent seeking tax more than makes up what they put in addition in the wage tax. Okay. So what you see is like this. And so now I have 5 minutes, which I promised I would give to questions. 2 minutes. Okay. So the idea here is very simple. In order for there to be a change, both of these groups have to agree. Look what happens here. So suppose, in fact, that the status quo is here. So you have something like this. Then there will not be a change ever that both groups agree to. Because this group here, group two, has income out there. And anything with stronger institutions, anything like that will give them less income. So these people have a comparative advantage, and they like institutions, will veto stronger institutions. So any status quo in this interval will be preserved in perpetuity. And you make the same argument here, any status quo, because these people will veto change. And here, if you go here, any change from here will be vetoed by the green group. The green line, group one, because that will reduce income. Anything substantially bigger than institutions will reduce the income. What you see is that the institutions here, bad ones, and strong ones here, preserved. The only change you can have is in the middle. If institutions are in the middle, there's a chance of reforming up or reforming down. Here, you can only reform down. Here, you can only reform up. Okay? Governed countries become better governed, better governed become worse governed. And there's room for improvement. But I'm going to stop here.
Sorry. Why does that green line go down at the beginning?